wherever you may be and however you may be listening. iHeartRadio, Fox Sports Radio, and FS1. We're also on Sirius XM Channel 83. Joy Taylor is joining me. Joy, how are you?
Great. Good morning.
We've got all sorts of stuff happening in the NFL, including by the end of the show, we could have a massive story. So don't go anywhere.
Is that Big J journalism?
We could have a massive story. 15 minutes, Brian Scalabrine will be joining us as well. Best for last. There's all these new relationships forming in the NFL. Antonio Brown, John Gruden. We'll give you our 10 most captivating relationships in the NFL this year. Some really interesting ones are forming. And again, in about 5 minutes, 7 minutes, I think a story could break. But the Thunder last night, this is a good Western Conference game. The Thunder beat the Jazz. They could meet in the playoffs. But we're all talking today about something else that happened during the game. So last night, Russell Westbrook, incident with a fan. Fan says he said something. Westbrook said he said something else. But what would worry me if I was the NBA is the frequency and the intensity of these situations. Now, the fan could be a big jerk. I've said before, I hate hecklers. I would have almost no tolerance if I was a general manager or any commissioner of a sport. But here's the thing. I can't control those fans. Maybe the guy's a racist. Maybe the guy's a jerk. And I'm not sure I can control Westbrook, but I should at least give him the tools to deal with this. More security, more space, maybe a watchdog around him to hear what fans are saying. Because what I'm concerned about is the frequency and the intensity of these situations. 3 years ago, and I'm not a psychologist, but 3 years ago, this was not Russell Westbrook. He was an 85% free throw shooter, and he was kind of a well-liked guy in the NBA. 3 years later, his game is deteriorating, and his personality is detonating. And that worries me. Last year, Utah. This year, Denver. Then the kid. Then the fan. I'm not saying fans can't be jerks. And I'm not saying in all these incidents, the fans aren't wrong. This fan, people say he was on internet. There was racist stuff on his account. I'm not denying that. But Russell Westbrook in the next week is going to go to another arena. It's not going to be empty. There's going to be fans there. And so who knows what happened to Westbrook to increase the intensity and the frequency of these? You know, I'm not a psychologist. Kevin Durant's gone on to star. Harden's gone on to star. Maybe that bothers him. Maybe the surgeries have made him, you know, less of a player. He's struggling with that. Maybe Paul George's emergence. I don't know. But this is just basic psychology stuff. It's the intensity and the frequency. Because it's not like he wasn't heckled 3 years ago. I sat at Laker games listening to Kobe Bryant get heckled. You don't think LeBron's been heckled? Michael Jordan heckling? And by the way, some of those could have been racial. I'm not, listen, there's inappropriate stuff in European soccer, international hockey, NBA. I'm not denying any of that. But like I told my son, I can't control fans. I can't control their kids. And I'm not sure I can control you or Westbrook. But I have to give you tools to better equip yourself. Adam Silver's got to step in. By the way, Roger Goodell's changing rules. Why? To protect players. Doesn't want his players hurt. These players are commodities. These players are assets. Okay, Russell Westbrook is the face of a franchise, the face of a division, and one of the seven faces of the league. Okay, and this is not going to get better. Fans are now sensing stuff bothers him, so they're poking, and they're poking, and they're poking, and they're dangling, and they're poking, and it's getting worse. This is where a commissioner has to step in and protect his player. And I don't have the answers, but I would hire security. I think I've seen it, you know, last night, James Harden's walking off the court, and he's high-fiving fans. I think fans are too close to players. I'm showing an incident on FS1 where there's a player, Russell Westbrook's on the floor, and a fan runs up to him. That's not appropriate. That's not appropriate. And in football, there is a gap between fans and player. In hockey, there's a wall. In baseball, God, in Oakland, it's like a parking lot between a first baseman and the fans. NBA, they're right on top of the players. And these are young players, and their stars. And Adam Silver's recently said many are unhappy. They're on their Instagram. They're on their Twitter. The intensity and frequency of this stuff, you got to step in. And listen, I could, you know, I was saying this morning, he feels like Wes broken, not Westbrook. His shot's broken. His personality here is a little more unhinged than usual. And this stuff's escalating. So get him help. Get him security. Get him space. Get him a therapist. But this could end up being really bad, and I'm not going to just blame Westbrook if he throws a punch in the next 2 weeks. Okay, it's not going to be all on him. Listen, you got to be culpable. I tell my son all the time, hey, it's how you handle this chaos. So you'll be eventually to blame. But players, most millionaires in America, you know, you get to be 50, you've worked hard, you put money away. Pro sports is cruel. Hey, you're 24. Here's a pile of money. Well, I don't know exactly. Stress. Here's a bunch of fame. Well, I'm from a small town. I'm 25 years old. Pro sports is rough. And I know nobody wants to hear it because they're all rich. But these players are increasingly targets, fans on top. They've sold the tickets next to the players. Fans can be jerks. Somebody's got to help Westbrook. That is the role of a commissioner. Protect your players. Also, there is a story here is developing. Ian Rappaport at Rap Sheet. The Jets have made a best and final offer to Le'Veon Bell, who lost $14.5 million last year by sitting out the season. So Le'Veon Bell's looking for a big payment, right? The Ravens are still in it as well, said Ian Rappaport. Le'Veon Bell has indicated to friends around the league how much he likes Baltimore. Ravens and Jets for Bell. Now, there's a lot of interesting things here, first of all. I'm not sure why this has taken long because everybody's already gotten paid. I mean, this thing happened fast. Everybody's getting money fast. The guys that were good players got paid fast. The average players got overpaid. I don't know what the weight is on Le'Veon Bell. He lost $14.5 million last year not playing, and running backs generally don't make a fortune. Are the offers not as rich as Le'Veon Bell wants? He's been suspended twice. He had a torn knee, and he's got heavy usage. So I don't think the offers are going to be quite as gigantic as Le'Veon Bell wants. Maybe that's why it's slow to come around. I don't think there's a ton of offers. Todd Gurley signed with the Rams. They spotted arthritis. I think that scared teams off. We have a history in the NFL where you could go find running backs, Kareem Hunt's all over this draft. There's a history in the NFL of being great running backs that weren't even drafted. So I'm kind of interested in the pace of this. Everybody's gotten paid very quickly. Average guys have gotten paid. Almost everybody's getting overpaid. What's the weight on Le'Veon Bell? Now, the Jets appeared to be out of the sweepstakes until Anthony Barr, who they thought they had, went back to the Vikings. That cleared up money. Now, I do think this helps Sam Darnold. Of all the teams in free agent moves, I like what the Jets have done. They went and got a Pro Bowl guard from the Raiders. That was one of their weaknesses. They went and got a slot receiver from Washington, Crowder. Very clever, crafty interior receiver. Adam Gase, that's a perfect player for him. Le'Veon Bell would be a pass-catching running back. They have a young tight end I like, and they have Robbie Anderson, a deep threat. So what the Jets would be doing is basically something that I think is really smart. We've got this franchise quarterback. He did not work with a defensive head coach. We're bringing in an offensive coach, a slot receiver, drafting the line, acquiring line, star running back. It makes a lot of sense for the New York Jets. Now, it similarly does for the Ravens. I think both these fits are very good for him. The Ravens have a young quarterback. All young quarterbacks benefit from star running backs. But Lamar Jackson seemed to very quickly work well with tight ends. Baltimore going forward is going to run the football a lot. It's their culture, and it's how Lamar plays. I think he fits Baltimore perfectly. In fact, when the season ended, my first gut feeling on Le'Veon Bell was Baltimore. I thought it was the perfect fit for him. He's really, Lamar Jackson is going to need a great running back. That's going to work. I think Mitch Trubisky similarly. Mitch Trubisky and Lamar Jackson, I never think are going to be elite world class throwers of the football. They could both really use a pound it running back. The Jets, Darnold's a better thrower than Trubisky, Lamar Jackson, in my opinion. they could go draft a running back and be fine. This would expedite Darnold's weapons and perhaps expedite his improvement and production, certainly. So that's the story right now. Le'Veon Bell, Baltimore, and the Jets are the leaders. There were a couple of teams out there that I heard about. There was a rumor about the Colts. I never really bought that. I don't think he fits their culture. Listen, it's going to be interesting. Everybody's signed. Like, everybody's done. I do wonder why Le'Veon Bell is still out there. With his talent and with the urgency of the other signings, it makes me suspect maybe the offers are not as great as he wanted. Remember, he lost $14.5 million not playing last year. So he wants to hit a home run. He doesn't want to sign cheap. By the way, the Packers also a bunch of free agent signings. So far, three defensive players. Adrian Amos, a very good safety from the Bears. Then it's a bunch of mid-level free agent guys. Preston Smith, Billy Turner, not expensive guys. Mid-level free agent guys, three on defense where they need help. Brian Scalabrine is around the corner. Dollar Shave Club starts as a company selling inexpensive razors and shipping them to your home. They took out the headache of going to the big box retailer and the rows and rows of razors for guys that were overpriced, and it was a complex labyrinth of trying to find the right razor for your face. Well, Dollar Shave Club now is not just razors. Body wash, hair gel, shampoos, conditioners. They've got toothbrushes, toothpaste, a handsome discount. The more you buy, the more you save. They also have a program where they automatically keep you stocked up on the products you use. It's very easy and very efficient. Right now, they want to get you in for $5, and after that, they'll ship regular-sized products at regular prices. But try the oral care kit. What are you waiting for? They make it easy. DollarShaveClub.com/Colin, C-O-L-I-N. Everything you need, fully stocked. You don't run out. Look, feel, smell your best. Don't have to go to the store anymore. Dollar Shave Club.